Isso, um motivo breve, lógico, recorde.
Finally, we can start. So I'm happy that we can start now, finally. I thank the organizers for giving me the possibility to start this conference. The topic of the conference is geometry integrability, and by chance, the subject of my talk with some geometric aspects of KP integrable hierarchy. So it fits very well to the main title of the conference. So this is the join, is based on a joint activity with my colleagues, Sasha Alexandrov, Bory Bychkov, Peter Dundin-Barkovsky, and Sergei Shadrin. And this is the title, topological recursion, XY duality, and KP integrability. So I repeat the title. The title consists of three concepts: the topological recursion, XY duality, and KP integrability. And I'm going to relate these three subjects. And they become more and more fashionable last year. So still, I'm not sure to what extent the participants are familiar with these concepts. So I will recall briefly what do they mean, and then I will explain how they are related to each other. In all the cases, the problem is like that. We have some number of, some collection of quantities labeled by a partition, consisting of the normal sequence of integers, of positive integers, and also there is one more parameter G, which is has the meaning of genus, but just for a moment it's just some extra integer. And these numbers are organized in such a generating series called potential, and the goal is just to compute it. Sometimes it is called also partition function, but usually the term partition function is reserved for the exponential of the potential. But anyway, and there are huge amount of problems in mathematical physics where this kind of objects do appear. For instance, these quantities could be some enumerative invariance, say enumeration of Hurwitz numbers, which enumerate ramified covering of a Riemann sphere, or in other words, some combinatorics of permutation groups. And some other cases, there are some variations of these Hurwitz numbers. And also, say, they appear in enumeration of maps, also with very different kinds of possibilities. And in particular, this enumeration of maps, a map of maps appeared originally in what is called matrix models. So various matrix models lead also to correlators of this type that could be computed. And there are many, many other instances. For instance, Gromov-Witten invariants, or more general correlators of cohomological field series, and many others. So I put here Weyl-Peterson volumes of modular spaces of curves, and Mazur-Witch volumes of models of abelian differentials, and many, many other. There are dozen and dozen problems which use the same language. And it happens that in many, many cases, all these problems could be solved in a uniform way using what is called topological recursion. So let me recall what's topological recursion. So I started with the potential, but there are different ways to pack to pack the same quantities to a generative series. First of all, we constitute what's called the correlator function. So you see the difference between the two expansions, that here we use one and the same collection of variables for all correlators, and the KI indices, we put here these KI indices to the indices of the variables. But instead, in the correlator function, we use the number of variables depends on the number of lengths of partition, and the K indices are put to the exponents of X variables. So we have each individual set of variables for each particular N. So collection of these correlator functions carries just the same information as the original potential. It proves out that it's more convenient in the computations actually to differentiate this this function with respect to each of the variable and to consider what is called correlator differential. So correlator differential is just a different way to collect the same quantities into generative series. So we use here just the differential of this monomial. So dxi is just a formal symbol. We mean, if you wish, symmetric product of the corresponding differential. So this is a differential one form with respect to each of the determinants. So the topological recursion computes actually not the potential, but the corresponding differentials. These computations use the following strategy. So in the original problem, we deal with formal power series, and both the original potential and the differential are just formal power series. But we look for a change of variables such that for the new variables, for z variables, the corresponding differential becomes rational. So if such a change of coordinates does exist, then we call that the potential possesses what is called rational spectral curve. So z is a coordinate on this rational spectral curve, and x is just a function on the spectral curve. This change is just the same for all g and n, and if such a change does exist, then there is a possibility to write this differential in the closed form, because a rational function is covered by a finite number of its coefficients. So the goal is to compute this differential in z coordinates using this rational form. So the language is as follows. So we have a spectral curve. In our case, it's just a projective line with a affine coordinate z. And our differentials are global meromorphic differentials on this spectral curve, or on the Cartesian power of the spectral curve. And then we have some just distinguished point of the spectral curve and then local coordinate x, and we take this globally defined meromorphic form and expand with respect to this local coordinate, and this is what we are interested in. So our goal is to compute this power expansion in the local coordinate x, but the computation use the fact that this differential is global and meromorphic. So let me recall how the topological recursion looks like. Just a small remark that this meromorphic property has some modification for the exceptional so-called unstable cases when GM 0, 1 or 0, 2. In particular, for 0, 2, correlators of genus zero, we add artificially such a singular term. So this differential becomes singular along the diagonal. This is a just usual definition that we use for other gn, and then we add artificially this singular term, and it proves out that in many, many cases, the resulting differential becomes globally defined differential like that, when z is a global affine coordinate on CP1. So it is globally defined, but this is just a technical detail. So how the topological recursion works? It was the topological recursion was invented by Chekhov in R10 as the connection with matrix models. And so let me present how it looks like. It's my definition is slightly differs from what we could find in the original papers of Chekhov and R10, but the idea is just exactly the same. So the idea is to compute these differentials starting from the initial data of recursion, and the initial data is just pair of functions denoted by x and z. So two rational functions, x and z, carry all information about all these differentials omega gn, and so we can recover, hence we can recover the potential just from two rational functions. So in the unstable cases,
x and y.
X and y. X and y.
You don't want to use any integrability ideas on that. Yeah?
For a moment, no. For a moment, no.
Because it's from an integrable point of view, it's very natural. Yeah, like it's a curve which you have data.
We will discuss it. Yeah, in a minute. So how the topological recursion works? We try to compute these differentials, and the idea is to impose certain conditions on these differentials. The first one is that if you consider this as a one form with respect to the first variable z1, it has very specific points where it possesses poles. So as a differential form as a meromorphic form in Z1, it is a form which has poles as the prescribed points, and these points are just zero points of dx. So we take this x function from the initial data of recursion, take its critical points, zeros of dx, and these are the only poles that this omega would possess. So in order to identify this differential form, we first identify the principal parts of these poles. So the principal parts of the poles are determined by what is called a loop equation. I do not write it explicitly, but this is an explicit expression in terms of previously computed differentials. It gives, how to say, the first approximation of the desired differential, which has a correct principal part of the poles at zeros of dx, but we do not know exactly what's the correct behavior of this outside these poles. So this loops equation looks as follows. On the left hand side, we have these differentials. And on the right hand side, we have some combination of previously computed differentials. And the quality does not hold identically, but the quality holds up to some terms which are holomorphic at the zeros of dx. So it's really a kind of first approximation of the desired form. And then on the second step, we just pick this principal part of the poles, and any meromorphic form could be recovered from the principal part of the poles. There is an explicit residual formula for that, but the definition is like that. We know the principal part of the poles, and then we can recover the differentials. So this procedure looks indeed very strange. We are interested in the power expansion of this differential at some specific point, but instead the recursion studies the local behavior of these differentials at the points which are very far from the expansion point. So the meromorphy of the corresponding differentials is implemented essentially to the very procedure of topological recursion. And these points where the differentials dx is equal to zero are situated even beyond the convergence radius of this original expansion, just because the poles are bounds for the convergence radius for these differentials. So this is how the topological recursion works, and it proves out that it is a really powerful tool. And many problems in mathematical physics could be computed using this procedure. And at the moment, it's a kind of belief that if you have a problem, usually the question, the usual question is not whether it admits a topological recursion, but the question is how to organize the data of the problem such that topological recursion will take place. So this is really, really universal feature of many problems. But this procedure requires some study of computation at the zeros of dx. In some simple cases, dx has few number of zeros, it's easy to study, but if the degree of x becomes greater, then the pole, the corresponding position of poles becomes more complicated. They are given by some algebraic equations, and so this computation involves some algebraic extensions of integer numbers, but even though the original series contains rational numbers only. So it's a very powerful tool, but not always convenient for practical computation. Instead, we discovered with our colleagues one peculiar relation which allows one to avoid this complicated application of topological recursion. And this is called XY duality. So this is XY duality, the second concept of my talk. The first one is topological recursion, the second XY duality, and the third one will be KP integrability. So we have some original collection of differentials, and XY duality produces a new collection of differentials. And there are closed algebraic equations which allows one to produce a new system of differentials from the original one. And this procedure involves a quite explicit formula, which involves summation over the graphs. This expression is quite complicated, looks complicated, but it's very explicit and it's easy to implement it and just to make computer experiments. So the best way to read this formula from right to left. So we take these differentials. Differentials for some number of entries, for number of variables, and for different genera. Then we divide these by the differentials to make it a function. So essentially, this is the same as the differential, but the differential is just one form, and this is just a function. So it's easier to handle functions. Then we apply certain differential operator. We differentiate with respect to each of the arguments. And then we specify these arguments of the resulting expression according to the combinatorics of the graphs appearing in this computation. And so this is a certain polynomial combination of the original differentials and their derivatives. This expression in brackets involves some additional parameters u1, un. So we take It's actually polynomial in these parameters in each exponent of h bar. And this sum is actually finite if you restrict to a particular exponent of h bar parameter. So we take a coefficient of each particular monomial in u variables and differentiate with respect to y variables. So it's quite complicated, but as I said, it's quite explicit. And this is really a duality. If you just swap the role of x and y variables, then you can restore the original differential from the dual one. So this is there is certain motivation for this formula, but anyway, there is an explicit formula how starting from a given collection of differential produce a new one.
Is it some correlated to the kind of Fourier transform?
It's
some simple cases.
I would say that it would be related to formalism in the Fock space to vertex separated formalism is the Fock space. So usually in the Fock space, we deal with differentials, with potentials. So there are certain differential operators applied to the potentials, but here we just translate to the language of differentials. So it's a...
Just this new transformation on top, which is play, it's kind of a genre, right?
Yes, so it looks like that, yes.
Kind of free, like in simple cases was found more than 30 years ago. But of course, from your formula, it's very hard to recognize.
Fourier transform, Laplace transform, this is very the kind of interpretation like that.
Yeah.
But anyway, the main feature that this transformation, this XY duality preserves the property of topological recursion. So if we are able to compute topological recursion on one side of duality, there is no need to apply the topological recursion directly on the other side of duality. We just apply these equations, these relations, and this is a nice theorem. So if we just have one example of topological recursion for which we know the answer, we can swap x and y variables, and this produces immediately the answer on the other side of duality. And this theorem has an obvious specialization. It happens quite often that the y variable of the spectral curve data is just z or z inverse of degree one. So if it is of degree one, it means that it has no critical points at all. It means that the topological recursion on the other side of duality is trivial. Yeah. By the way, the two topological recursions for these two systems of differentials are absolutely different. So the first one. Deals has poles at zeros of dx, and this one has poles at zeros of dy. So they have really different collection of poles, and so they look quite different. So in particular, if dy has no zeros, then the dual topological recursion has no poles, and all differentials are just zero. And so in all the cases when we have topological recursion with a spectral curve data such that y function is just z or z inverse, these corresponding topological recursion differentials have an explicit expression, and the topological recursion is not needed to be applied directly. This is very convenient, and we have a really close formulas which does not involve application of this complicated procedure of topological recursion, which recovers the corresponding differentials and therefore thereby the potential itself. So now let me switch to the third object of the title, the KP integrability. So the KP hierarchy, the system of partial differential equations, infinite system of partial differential equations on the unknown function in countably many variables. So these are the first two equations of this hierarchy. The bottom indices denote the corresponding partial derivatives. So you see the system is nonlinear. It has finitely many constant coefficients, but it's nonlinear, so it's quite complicated. There is a rule how to construct equations of this hierarchy, and we look for solutions of this hierarchy. Actually, probably you know very well, it's well studied. There are huge theory beside this hierarchy, the wave functions, Hirota equations, and so on. Satograssmanian and so on. But let's look at the KP integrability from the point of view of correlator differentials. So assume that we have a system of correlator differentials, we have an expansion point and a local coordinate, and we produce the corresponding potential. But what happens if we change the local coordinate or the expansion point? So it happens that to a given collection of differential, we have associated not just one potential, but a huge family of potentials, and they're labeled by a choice of expansion point and the corresponding local coordinate. Of course, these points should be chosen such that it's regular for all the differentials. So the differentials have no poles at this point, so the corresponding differentials. So we just take such a regular point, take the power expansion of these differentials, and then just combines from the coefficients of this expansion, the corresponding Taylor coefficients of the potential. And it proves out that the main principle says that actually it proves out that the KP integrability property does not depend on the choice of the expansion point. If the corresponding potential is KP solution of KP hierarchy for some point and some local coordinate, that it's also a solution of KP hierarchy for any other point and any other local coordinate. This is not even a theorem, but it's a principle, and it's so fundamental. So I'm really very surprised that we never found such a statement in the literature, because it really looks very natural and very general. And as usual, whenever we have some general result, it has several different proofs. So in this case, we have at least two independent proofs of this statement. And I will discuss later one of them.
Reminds me very much what was called long ago with Euclidean hierarchies.
This is the equivalent hierarchy deals with just local change of coordinates at the point. And this is the just globalization of this property. So in the change of local coordinate, we also allow to shift to origin. So it's yes, for the changes just with the fixed O, it's the action of the Virasoro group that it's well known, KP integrability. So if you change just the local coordinate, it's the action of the Virasoro group. And then since the KP integrability is a global feature which could be applied to a system of differentials, we wonder whether the XY duality transformation preserves this property, and it proves that it's the case. So if we start from a system of differentials which possesses this KP integrability property, that on the dual side of duality, we still have KP integrability. And as immediate corollary, we obtain that the fact that the topological recursion potential associated with any spectral curve such that y of z is of degree one does satisfy KP hierarchy. Indeed, it's just there is nothing to prove here. We know that the corresponding differentials are xy dual to the system of differentials which are trivial. But for the trivial system of differentials, the corresponding KP equations hold identical because zero is an obvious solution of KP hierarchy. And so we get this property. So in all the cases where we have such a spectral curve data, we immediately obtain a solution of KP hierarchy. And by the way, depending on the problem, the expansion point and the local coordinate of the expansion point is chosen differently, but this property doesn't depend on the choice of the local coordinate and expansion point. So for any expansion point. And let me show you.
Probably if X is a polynomial of some power, this is not only KP hierarchy, but it's corresponding reduction.
Yes, of course. Yes, that's true. But it's easier to complement. Yeah, just observation. Yeah, that's true. So this spectral curve is what is known. That is responsible for the potential, which is called Witten's R-spin potential, which participates in his R-spin conjecture. For R equal to 2 is the corresponding Kolchak-Witten potential, but for greater R, it's an R-spin analog of that one. So the X is a monomial in R. It has a critical point at the origin. But at the infinity, it has a pole. So the whole topological recursion studies the behavior at the origin, but the infinity is a regular point. The corresponding differentials have no singularities at infinity. So we take the infinity as a base point of the expansion, and for the local coordinate, we choose z inverse. And the corresponding potential is just exactly the Witten's R-spin potential. And similarly, if we just consider this case, again, X is the monomial in R and Y is Z inverse. So at the origin, again, X has a critical point at the origin and Y has a pole at the critical point. So it's not the usual topological recursion, but what's called the regular topological recursion, but the main principle is just the same. So we apply this topological recursion. Again, the infinity is a regular point. And so we expand the infinity in the local coordinate z inverse. And the result is what is called RBGW potential, which is R spin analog of BGW potential. The potential itself was introduced a long time ago and by Mironov, Morozov, Semyonov, and they presented the matrix model for this potential, and from this matrix model, it follows that it's a solution of KP hierarchy and so on. And then there was a conjecture that the conjectural spectral curve for the topological recursion for this matrix model, and it was like that. And this conjecture was formulated by Alexandrov and Hara, and also by this Chidambaram, Garcia Fayud, and Yachetta. And also for this spectral curve, these authors produced the corresponding homological field theory, which produces potential. So on one side, we have a matrix model producing the potential for which we know the KP hierarchy. And on the other hand, we know the homological field theory, which shows that this spectral curve produces the potential of the corresponding of FT. And there was a conjecture that they're the same. And in our setting, it is just the obvious corollary. And we know that now that this conjecture is true. And by the way, this PP integrability for the potential for the spectral curve was announced recently in the conference in the Sochi. There was, as long as I know, this is true, and one of these authors is a participant of our conference. Yeah. But anyway, we said that actually, this is actually the result of much, much real, but not just establish the KP integrability of the responding potential, but we say that the result is much, much more general. So instead of, instead of just a monomial, we could put any rational function, the result will be KP integrable. And also we can choose, change the expansion point, and even more, as I will show, we can identify explicitly the solution. So we not just prove the KP integrability, but we identify the solution. So we provide the corresponding point on the Grassmannian, on the SATA Grassmannian, provide Katz-Schwarz operators, and so on. So this solution is identified explicitly. So the equivalence of the corresponding two potentials is established in a very, very explicit form. So these are the main results that I wanted to announce. So the first one, once again, is the first one is the
полный экран держал презентацию.
Чего-то, да, сейчас я.
Окей, нажми.
Вот сервис.
Я вот в меню вид, там есть передана режим презентации. Вот, презентация.
Окей. Okay. So, yeah. So the first result of this globalization principle that the KP integrability is a property of the system with potential, and the second result is the XY duality preserves this property. And now I would like to discuss a little bit the proof, but rather not the proof, but also some additional structures appeared in the proof. So I would like to make these theorems more explicit and more manifestating. So I will, since we know that the KP integrability is internal property of the system of differentials, the natural question appears is, given a system of differentials, how to see that the given system of differentials is really KP integrable, how to formulate KP integrability in the internal terms of the system of differentials. And this is what I am going to discuss now. So there is one of the, there is one interesting interpretation of the solutions of KP hierarchy using what is called Baker-Heiser kernel. So given potential, so potential is the power series in the variables P1, P2, and P3, and so on, we produce what's called the Baker-Heiser kernel. It's a function in just two variables, X1 and X2. So we just put, we take this specialization of the p variables, then we take the exponent, the exponential, which is the corresponding partition function, the tau function, and then divide over x1 minus x2. So this function in x1, x2, it has a leading term singularity at the diagonal, 1 over x1 minus x2, plus a regular series in x1 and x2. And it happens that this this function in two variables carries all necessary information about the solution. So it encodes the solution in Euclid, it determines the corresponding point of the Christmanian and so on. So the, all the properties of the solution could be recovered from this function. So at the moment, we define this function just as a series in x1, x2, so to be precise, the singular term, 1 over x1 minus x2 plus a series in x1, x2. But now I want to globalize this proper this object. So starting from a system of differentials, I associate the potential to a particular expansion point and its particular local coordinate, and I compute the corresponding kernel with respect to this expansion data. And then I just add this factor. So I produce a half differential in both arguments. So fat is just another instance of this kernel K, but it's not a function anymore. It's half differential, half differential.
Yeah, but two fermionic problem.
Hmm?
It's correlator of two fermions. That's why it's half differential.
Oh, it's that's true. Yeah. But when you say it this way, you have in mind still power expansion side points on Fock space. But what's important for me is that this object is defined globally. The statement, the theorem says that it's defined globally. It's a global meromorphic half differential on the spectral curve. So you take, if you just, what does it mean that it's globally defined? So if you take this K and take any other point on the spectral curve, any other local coordinates at this spectral curve, and apply this expansion, that this K associated with a new point, a new expansion point, will be the one associated with the corresponding potential. So this K is a globalization, global version of this K kernel. So this K could be computed in terms of the original system of differential, and is globally defined. And then the KP hierarchy could be written in terms of this K as follows. It's just the determinant formulas, the differentials, the differentials of our system with differentials could be computed as certain determinants or certain determinants produced by matrices whose entries are just this K kernel. So as the usual determinant, we compute the sum of a cyclic set of permutations. Then we have this contribution of the diagonal of this permutation. But here I use what is called connected determinant. So we use only not all the permutations, but only those which form length n cycle. So Cn is the set of lengths n cycles in the set of all permutations. All these cycles have a sign equal to n minus one. So we could use this as a common factor. So this is just the sign of any permutation consisting of a single length n cycle.
Sorry, and where is h on the right?
It's hidden here. So f involves h expansion, so k is a series in H. So this is also a series in H. So for a local, for if you expand both sides at the point O with respect to local coordinates x coordinates, then this is a well-known equality, and this is a well-known characterization of KP hierarchy. But what's important is that both sides are globally defined. Both sides are global meromorphic objects, and this equality holds identically. So if we restrict this equality to any particular point and to any particular local coordinate, this, then we have an expansion corresponding to the corresponding potential associated with this point. So this theorem provides a more explicit form of this globalization theorem. We not only claim that KP integrability is a global property, but we have an explicit global expression of KP integrability. So this equality is just an equivalent reformulation of KP integrability. And the same question is concerned with XY duality. If we have a KP integrable system of differentials, then on the other side of KP of XY duality, we also have a KP integrable system of differentials. So it means that if in the original, the information of the original KP integrability is contained in the K kernel for the original system of differentials, then for the, on the other side of duality, we also have an integrable system of differentials and the corresponding K kernel. And there is a question how the K kernel of one side of XY duality is expressed in terms of K kernel of the other side of duality. And we have an explicit answer to this question. So we have KP integrable case. On both sides, we know that the corresponding system of differentials are KP integrable. Oops. So we have K kernel on one side, K kernel on the other side. So again, to write formula, I use functions rather than differentials. So I remove these half differential factors and express the corresponding K and K check and K for the corresponding kernels, which are functions rather than half differential. And this transformation.
Have you compared this formula with our formula of earlier times?
Not yet.
It's all here many times. There is a single integration or just of the same form.
Oh, it's I wish to.
Well, this duality transformation, that's what I meant by earlier transfer.
Mm-hmm. I wish to this, yeah. So, yeah, so this is one of the goals to make this this talk.
It's at least it's far more explicit, the transformation which we had at the beginning. Yeah, it's of course for very particular objects.
Mm-hmm.
Here for 2-point function, and we had, I believe, I forgot already, for one-point function.
Oh, yeah.
But this is just a kind of a Fourier transform, which is natural.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'll look at once again at this. Yeah, because when you told me before, I know more. So now probably your information will be more clear for me. Okay. So on the right hand side we have such a strange integral. And for a moment it's not clear what to integrate and what's the domain of integration, how to interpret this integrate. But this is explained here. So what we have in the exponential here is some function which has a critical point at W1 equal to Z2 and W2 equal to Z1. So we make a shift of variables at the critical point, and then we have to interpret these integrals in the asymptotic expansion. So after this shift of variables, these integrals become what is called formal Gaussian integral of this sort. So we have, we know that if A is a positive real number, then the derivative from minus infinity to plus infinity, we obtain this answer. But at the moment, we could take the, treat this just formally. A is just a formal parameter, not necessarily positive integer. So we just take this equality by definition. So by this shift of variables, this integral could be reduced to this one. So the expansion of h bar, each term has a form of Gaussian integral, the exponential of a quadratic form times some polynomial in xi variables. So we can apply this formula to compute this transformation. So for instance, using this equality, I implemented this computer and made a lot of explicit experimental computations with this formula. So this expression allows one to not only to prove the KP integrability on the other side of xy duality, but also to identify explicitly the solution, because we know from this equality we know the corresponding kernel, Baker Kayser kernel, and hence we can identify the solution. So for instance, for this example that I mentioned, the RPGW, we know explicitly what the K kernel for this potential, and we know how to identify the corresponding solution. And let me give the last remark. In the study, of today's talk, I always assumed that the spectral curve is rational. And there is a question, there's a natural question, why I do restrict myself to this special case? Is it possible to treat also the case when the spectral curve has positive genus? And of course, the topological recursion, for instance, does exist for on the curve of any genera. But it proves out, however, that in the context of KP integrability, we need to have to restrict ourselves to the case of rational spectral curves. Namely, there is a quite old result of Takasaki and Takebe that says that if you have a solution of KP hierarchy, then applying the action of Virasoro group, we can eliminate 0-2 terms of the corresponding solution. So in another language, so for the corresponding 0-2 correlator function differential, we could always choose the local coordinate z instead of x, such that for the new coordinate z, the 0-2 differential is just like that. So usually if you just take a random local coordinate, we have a singular term like that plus a regular series. So it proves out that applying a suitable change of coordinates, we can kill all the remaining series. And this in the context of global KP integrability, we can prove that, we can show that this local coordinate z extends as a global meromorphic actually function. So we have that our 0-2 differential has such a form for such for some global meromorphic function. So this differential has a singularity on the diagonal, but if we have that z is not if the z is a meromorphic function has degree greater than one, then we have other poles which are related by the Degen transformation of this function z. So if we assume that the 0-2 differential has no other false other than the, on the diagonal, we should assume that Z of degree one. So Z is of degree one, it means that the spectral curve is rational, Z is a global affine coordinate, uniforming coordinate. And this is exactly what happens in the context of topological recursion. The topological recursion, we always assume that the zero two differential, the so-called Berman kernel, has some singularity on the diagonal, but has no singularities apart from the diagonal. So the only case when this is compatible with KP integrability is just the case of genus zero. So this KP integrability property holds only for the case of rational spectral curves. That's why I restrict myself for the whole talk that the spectral curve is rational. Okay, thank you very much.
Where is the creature at? We can make x and y, dx and dy. We know what the differential would take the one can always take the.
I would say that creature data is just one of the examples, one of the special cases. So we associate the solution.
Which your data, well, in general, it goes beyond the keys because it, you can take any curve, not necessarily rational.
Yes, 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 yes.
In your case, these are just, I think, maybe right, dx and dy, two differentials with fixed periods. In your case, the periods are zero because these are trouble.
Yeah, but what's interesting is, check, it might happen that the from the point of view of the topological recursion, the spectral curve data associated with the Kirchhoff data is not the curve for which the Kirchhoff data is constructed, but some other informed directional. I will check.
So, gene is zero.
Hmm?
Gene is zero anyway.
I guess, but I need to check.
You can try to make this construction for any kind of curve. But you won't get KP. What I understand, what was clear.
Yeah. Well,
with the maximum, rigorously, that KP would correspond.
This is very, very nice question. And we addressed ourselves the question many times, but we didn't answer it yet. I would say that here, it might happen that the curve like that, the differential like that does exist on the curve of genus greater than zero. We just take any meromorphic function, we take Riemann surface, algebraic curve, just any meromorphic function of Z and produce differential like this. So it's not related to topological recursion, but it very fits very nice to KP integrability. I don't know explicit answer to the question, but I have to know.
Isn't it related either to square of Sugar kernel or to this phase with the direction, which to fix if it's not in a rational key? You have to fix it by fixing some period.
Right? Yeah.
Otherwise, it's not defined up to addition of something or more.
Yes. So this is what I said, that in this case, in the context of topological recursion, zero to differential has singularity on the diagonal, and then you fix the periods. And it never has the form like that, except for the genus zero. So this is a, for instance, let me consider the simplest case. So you take, for instance, well, there are many meromorphic functions, so you can, for any meromorphic functions, you can write expression like that, but it has singularities apart from the diagonal. So it's not, doesn't suit for the Berman kernel. So it doesn't work for the KP, for topological recursion, but for keeping integrability, it should work.
So I'm really confused about this, because as you mentioned, we have some work related to this, and we have an example of Smith 1, which is the best part of the curve, and his kernel is has some I mean other terms, not just the leading term.
Yeah.
It also has some other terms. Well, it needs a solution of PBT.
Really?
Of course it's.
But yeah, I agree that this does contradict what I said. So let's discuss it.
Yeah, that makes me confused. In fact, last week, the talking topic, I introduced that example. So
I'm interested in checking this example. Yeah.
Okay.
Will you discuss this in your talk?
No, I will talk about another thing. We consider as a explicit special curve, and we consider the Bergman kernel in the James Bond special curve, and we prove that in fact, part of the potential field is the PDB of the reduction.
It's a very interesting case.
What was? Otherwise, we can continue doing problems here of the network.
With the problems, you can see that can be open and interesting. Whether you have solved or who that, everything in topological recursion.
You know that. Yeah, there are many applications or particular applications of this topological recursion with KP integrability for particular problems, but on the other hand, there are general features like that. The general form. Still, at the moment, topological recursion, even though it is proved for several dozen of particular cases, it's still a kind of mystery. So still, the goal is to understand what's hidden behind this theory. I wouldn't say that I have some particular special case in mind, but it proves out that the bigger we study the problem, the new aspects of this problem appears and opens, and we have new relationships and it provides a new understanding of all the results, so like that.
Let's continue the process with discussion during the public break, and then we start the discussion. Let's say, what do you want? Yeah.